Start, sir.
Right, okay then, fine. Is the voice clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Right. Who is admitting anybody? Everybody can auto admit, isn't it? You do not have to do anything.
I am admitting everyone, sir.
Okay, fine. Right. So, good morning, all.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, right. So without much delay, we'll start it. Otherwise, I think it may be a bit difficult to finish on time. Right. So I'm Dr. Akbar. I'm a pediatric neurologist. I'm from 1996 KMC batch. And I did my MD pediatrics from PJ Chandigarh and DM pediatric neurology from the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. So the topic I've decided for today is 10 commandments in cerebral palsy. So the first image that I put in my slide is about some images of children with cerebral palsy. I'm sure most of you are from final year students, right? And would have had pediatrics posting. So the moment I say a child with cerebral palsy, we tend to remember children with disabilities, children who are like wheelchair bound, children who are bed bound, having multiple issues, right? But these children are also like any other children, and they do enjoy their life sometimes much more than the other children, okay? So the crux of today's talk would be just understanding some of the basic concepts overall, okay? So I thought I'll just start with a small analysis of a case sheet or a case study. And whoever are there, they can write their answers in the chat box. Let us see that what they think about this particular case study. Okay, and then we'll go to the topic per se. So this is like a 8-year-old born girl, 34 weeks of gestation, okay, had a prolonged NICU stay for 3 months because of so many issues, multiple issues, birth asphyxia, severe neonatal jaundice, pneumonia. She had a global developmental delay in milestones, and currently she could speak, she can read sentences, and she can understand and she can obey simple commands, okay? She can sit with support, but cannot sit without support. She cannot stand, and she cannot walk independently. She can eat by herself, and she can use a spoon to feed herself. She cannot unbutton the dress. Now, one of the statement regarding this particular case study is not true. So I just want the students to say which one of the statement is wrong in the chat box. Okay. So what is wrong as far as this particular case is concerned? This particular child can develop scoliosis in the future. You can just mention the number, you know, number 3, number 1 or number 2. Probably you can start one. So, right. She can be trained to operate simple machines. Is that true or false? She can participate in play activities with other children. She can have epilepsy in future. She can walk by 12 years of age with the help of walking aids. She can develop movement disorders in the future. She may require surgical intervention to prevent deformities. She will need assistance for activities of daily living. She can develop behavioral problems as a teenager. Right? She may require an enriched diet to prevent failure to thrive. So one of the statement regarding this particular case is wrong. Can the students just try to write what is wrong? Number 1 or number 2 or number 3? In the chat box. Right? Yes, like that. So this is about an 8-year-old girl, and we are just trying to see what and all issues she can have. And one of the issue or one of the problem she can have is not there. It is false. So there are 9 true statements and 1 false statements. Which one statement is false? We'll give like 10 more seconds. Right. I just encourage you to go ahead. Few more. It is just a beginning of the slide, just to say that how much issues a child can have. So which is wrong? Okay. Good. Good. Okay. Good. Okay, fine. Okay, so now just let me go through the messages that most of you have thought is that about scoliosis. Actually, it's a true statement. An 8-year-old girl child who's bedbound and bedridden in a wheelchair, who can just with support but cannot sit without support, can develop scoliosis. The answer for this is option number 5. She can walk by 12 years of age with the help of walking aids. A child who can just sit with support at 8 years has absolutely no chance of walking by 12 years of age. But trust, all the issues is what a child with CP can have. So if you look from purely from the exam point of view, okay, these are some of the presenting complaints a child with CP can come with, or the parents can come with. Okay, they can say that my child is having developmental delay. My child can only sit. My child can only stand. My child can only walk. Okay, my child cannot use one side of the body, or my child is having stiffness of legs, stiffness of hands. The parents can say that my child has abnormal movements, my child has seizures, my child has feeding issues, my child has pneumonia, and so on. Okay, so there are a multitude of presenting complaints in a child with cerebral palsy. So as a junior doctor, okay, you need to know history taking about development, history taking about abnormal movements, history taking about weakness, okay, analyzing history about posture, good history taking about epilepsy, and a history taking about comorbidities. So in this child, there are certain key points. If you see, one of the first key point is that she was a 34-week gestation. So she's a preterm child. She had birth asphyxia. That's another history point. Okay. She had a neonatal jaundice, which means that she's highly prone to have movement disorders. Her current level. Okay. The history then focuses about her current level, that she can read and she can speak, which automatically means that she's trainable. She can operate simple machines like mobile phones. Okay. She can handle computers, okay, she can read, so she can be trained to go to school. But she can only sit with support at 8 years, okay. A children usually around 6 months of age can sit with support. So she can only sit with support at 8 years, so which is absolutely bad. You need a child to sit without support at least by 4 years, and that is why she cannot walk by 12 years. It's absolutely too late. She can feed herself, so again, she can handle machines, okay. So what do you understand from this particular case study is that one child with the CP can have multitude of problems. It could be a neurological problem and it could be a non-neurological problem. Okay. And that comes to the topic per se. So today's topic per se, for those who have joined late, is about the 10 commandments in cerebral palsy. And I'm Dr. Akbar. I'm a pediatric neurologist. I'm from 1996 KMC batch. I did my pediatrics from PGH Chandigarh, and currently I'm a consultant pediatric neurologist here in Oman. So I would start with a disclaimer that I've been a faculty for PG training program, that is PG coaching for PG DMS, part of NEET medical coaching as well till 2019. So I'm absolutely sure that whenever we go into factual points, the students tend to get scared. So I do not intend to scare none of my students here. I want to keep it as simple as possible. I want to just tell few basic concepts, around 10 concepts, okay, in a simple and an organized way. I always know that university exams is important. All of you want just points for your exams, you know. You need points so that you can score more marks. But believe me, at the end of the day, it is a doctor who has clear concepts is much appreciated by the parents and the faculty per se. So the source I've taken to keep for simplicity purposes, for brevity and simplicity, is only OP Guy and Arishami. Okay. I've not gone into, you know, Nelson or Swyman or the other big textbooks of cerebral palsy so that I don't want you to bombard with extra additional information. Okay. So whatever I share today, whatever I speak today, if you just go back and read Arishami or read your OP Guy, I think things would be much more clear for you. So theme is only 10 concepts. At the end of the day, of the 10 concepts, I need have some 3 quizzes, just like what we had, so that your concepts are more steady. Okay. So we'll start. So all of you know that CP is a neurological syndrome. Okay. Why is cerebral palsy kept as an exam case is because it is a neurological syndrome with multiple signs and symptoms. You know, you can elicit a lot of signs and symptoms, and that's the reason that it is usually kept in an exam. And you know that this neurological syndrome is because of an old brain injury. I'm sure all of you attending the class, you are right now 60 of you, all of you know that cerebral palsy is because of old brain injury. I mean, that much you know, right? And you know, you have to analyze this neurological syndrome with taking a good history, right? And then you do a good proper examination, like a good neurological examination as you routinely do. And then you need to summarize the findings with the clinical summary. So if I'm an examiner sitting and asking you to examine a child with cerebral palsy, I am interested, how are you summarizing your history and how are you summarizing your examination findings by this last point, a clinical summary. So the one of the theme of this presentation is that how do you put a good clinical summary with main key points, okay? So let's focus on the basic concepts. It's not like the sequence of history, examination and findings. I'm not going into sequence. I'm just going on the sequence of, of how a patient would present to you in an OPD and what are the things that you are looking for, okay? And in the end, I will of course summarize with history, examination and summary, okay? Right, so these are the 10 commandments. These are the first slide, the 10 commandments. And we'll be seeing each of these one by one. So the first commandment or the first major point is that CP is a movement disorder. So those who have you never ever thought that CP could be a movement disorder, by definition, cerebral palsy is a movement disorder. Your movements are impaired, okay? This next concept is that there are various types of palsies in cerebral palsy. Palsy means an inability to perform or an impaired function. So there are multiple impaired function in cerebral palsy. The third command or the third main point is that not all cerebral palsy is due to birth asphyxia. A very common mistake. People think that if there is a cerebral palsy, something would have happened at the birth, okay, and that's why the child had a cerebral palsy. But cerebral palsies are usually because of remote asphyxias, okay? We'll see this concept. Different types of brain injury can produce different types of cerebral palsy. So you should need to have an idea about the timing of the brain injury insult. What time did the insult happen to the brain? And according to the timing of the insult, you can have different types of brain injury, and that can give you a clues regarding different types of cerebral palsy you can expect. The early bird gets the worm, and so the early identification and early rehabilitation helps immensely a child with cerebral palsy. So some concepts of rehabilitation we'll see. Life is better for children with CP if there is no progressive impairment. And this is why we doctors, pediatricians and neurologists are involved in children with CP, because you know cerebral palsy cannot be cured. It's not a medical conditions like dengue, typhoid or anything that you cure it completely, but you can definitely make the life of the children much better if you make sure that there is no progressive impairment of their deficits, okay? So this is the catch point. I don't want the deficit to impair much, get worsen over a period of time. Not every child with whose stiff is cerebral palsy. Beware of the cerebral palsy mimics. So you need to be just aware of a few conditions which can look like cerebral palsy but are not cerebral palsy. So an important concept of rehabilitation is that focus on ability and not on disability. You need to focus what a child can do. Like in the initial case, we saw an 8-year-old child who can read and who can feed herself. That is a very good ability. A child who can read and feed herself can be allowed to participate, in the school, can be allowed to participate with computer monitors, with mobile devices, etc. Okay, so she's much more trainable. Children with CP hate to go to hospital for medical issues like any children. Okay, you have children. All children hate to go to hospital if they have like constipation, if they have like hip dislocation, if they have epilepsy, right? So you need to handle their medical issues or non-neurological issues. And children with CP would love to participate in social life. They love to participate in sports, games, okay? They love to have friends. They are like any other children. So another important concept is that we need to help them in their social life, okay? So these are the 10 commandments. We'll see one by one. So cerebral palsy is a movement disorder. At this point, can just somebody think about, or maybe I'll just give 10 seconds in the chat box. Can somebody say what is the definition of CP in the chat box? Maybe two keen points. Let us give 20 seconds in the chat box. How do you define a CP? Yeah, I'm giving time around 20 seconds for you to type something. How do you define a CP? Cerebral palsy is a dash, dash, dash. Is due to old brain injury, right? Yes, cerebral palsy is due to old brain injury, but how do you define a cerebral palsy? Anybody else? We'll wait. It's a neurological syndrome, right? True. It's a permanent insert. How do you define the neurological syndrome? Neuromotor disorder. Good. There are two key words in the definition of cerebral palsy. I'm just looking for those two key words. Congenital disorder of movement, tone, and posture. Excellent. Okay. So this was the thing I was looking for. Somebody told the right word, non-progressive motor disorder. Answer is wrong. It is not a non-progressive motor disorder. We'll see to that. Very good. Excellent. I got one answer. It's a disorder of movement and posture. Okay. So this is the key word I was looking for. It's an impairment of movement and posture. If you don't tell these two words, then you are wrong. Then the entire definition is wrong, because you're going to define what are the abnormal movements you're going to have, and you're going to define what are the abnormal postures you can have. Okay. So these are the two key words, movement and posture. And one important is that it leads to activity limitation, isn't it? Because of an abnormal movement and abnormal posture, the child's activity is limited. And this is because of a non-progressive insult to the developing brain. The injury to the brain is non-progressive. Okay. It is not a progressive genetic disease. But having said that, the insult is non-progressive, but the symptoms can progress. The movement disorder can progress. Okay. Please take note of that. If you have a child who did not have a movement disorder at 2 years of age with CP, the same child can have new movement disorders when the child becomes 8 years or 9 years of age. Okay. So the movement disorder or the posture disorder can progress over time. Okay. That's important. Only the injury was old and the injury does not progress. So all these words are important. Okay. So if I'm an examiner, I would ask you to define CP, and I would looking for all these keywords. So in addition to movement disorder, there are multiple other comorbidities like epilepsy, gastric comorbidities, okay, skeletal deformities, multiple comorbidities, sensation issues, vision, hearing, and so on. Okay. So what is CP? CP is a movement disorder. CP is a posture disorder. CP causes activity limitation. CP is because of old insult. The problems in CP can change over a period of time. Okay. It should be absolutely clear about this definition. There should be zero mistake in this definition. So all of you know that if there are normal movement, okay, most of my slides would be only few lines. So don't worry. You need not focus on the slides. You can focus on what I'm trying to tell. Okay. So most of the normal movements, if you want to perform, right? Like for example, if I want to take this water bottle like this, okay. First, I would decide that I have to take this water bottle. Okay. I have to decide, I have to have this intention, and this intention comes from my frontal lobe, okay, my thinking networks. Then my hand goes towards the bottle, okay, so I direct my hand towards my bottle. So I need a good vision, okay, to target my hand towards the water bottle, right? So I have to decide, I have to plan for a moment, okay, that there are a few steps. I have to raise my hand, okay, extend my hand and go. So there's some degree of planning and some degree of sequence of movements. And there is a direction of a movement and there's an accuracy of the movement. So as you can understand, even a simple movement like just lifting the water bottle, okay, requires activity from different areas. My frontal lobe, my cerebellum, my corticospinal tracts, my basal ganglia, and so and so. So there are multiple brain networks which can help in a normal movement. I'm not going to the neuroanatomy. If you can just imagine, you would appreciate that. So what happens in cerebral palsy? There is abnormal movement and abnormal posture because of this motor impairment, right? And it can be in a small area or it can be in a big area. It can be in the frontal lobe. It can be in the cerebellum. It can be in the corticospinal tract. Okay. It can be in the basal ganglia, isn't it? And if there is one network, so, you know, the brain is almost like a cricket team or an IPL members. So all these 11 people play with each other. So even if one person is not playing appropriately, like, for example, Dhoni did not play properly, that's it. All the others go down. So if there is even impairment from one area of the brain, all the others go down. So primarily, if you talk in terms of from the exam point of view, you want to analyze whether this motor impairment is significantly from the pyramidal tracts, or is it significantly from the extrapyramidal tracts, or is it because combined? Okay. So this is what you're going to analyze. And how does a pyramidal tract causes some motor issues? How does an extrapyramidal tract causes motor issues? And how does a combined tract causes a motor issues? Okay. So another key point is that even though it is because of abnormal brain network issues, the problem is never at the level of lower motor neuron unit. The problem is always at the level of upper motor neuron. I'm sure all of you at least know what's an upper motor neuron and what is a lower motor neuron. So upper motor neuron is from your cortex, cerebral cortex, till the anterior horn cell. Okay. And lower motor neuron is from the anterior horn cell to downwards, like the nerves and the muscles and the neuromuscular junction. So cerebral palsy is always a upper motor neuron syndrome. Okay, it never affects your lower motor neuron syndrome. Okay, and that's the primary basic difference, where it is not more of a weakness, it's more of an unusual and an impaired movements. Whereas, just imagine if we had more of a lower motor neuron problem, like a muscle problem or a nerve problem, there will be a significant degree of weakness. So always remember, in a cerebral palsy, it is the movement control and posture control which is lost, and it is not much more of a weakness. It is not, weakness is there, but the weakness is a type of human type of weakness, and it is not a element type of a weakness. So I'm sure all of you know what is a pyramidal tract. Okay, always one side of the pyramidal tract controls the opposite side of the body. For example, in this image, the left side of your pyramidal tract, okay, starting from the Betz cells of the cerebral cortex, passing through the corona radiata, and then the internal capsule passing between your basal ganglia and the thalami, okay, and then at the level of the medulla, there's a decussation, and then passes downwards into the spinal cord as the lateral corticospinal tract, and influences the opposite side of the hand. But what you should remember is that a pyramidal tract, okay, primarily controls your fine movements, okay, and the fine control, like the finger movements and the distal movements, rather than the proximal muscles. Okay, so a child who's having an impaired handwriting or inability to use the hands properly to feed herself or to use the spoons, okay, to draw a circle, to throw a ball, is primarily because of a pyramidal tract dysfunction. Okay, so not able to button, not able to tie a shoelaces, all these things are issues are because of a pyramidal tract dysfunction. So whenever you are seeing a child with CP, okay, if you assess the hand function, and if the hand function is absolutely bad, you know that it is because of a pyramidal tract dysfunction. Okay, and also, of course, you know, a pyramidal tract has significant, you know, negative influence on the anterior horn cell, and once your pyramidal tract influence is lost, the muscles become stiff. It is because of overfiring at the level of your anterior horn cell. Okay, again, I'm not going into the anatomical details, but it's a very simple, is that there is a loss of a negative influence from your pyramidal tract, causes, okay, you know, exaggerated spinal reflexes or exaggerated release of firing from your gamma motor neurons and anterior horn cells, causing muscle stiffness. So stiffness is one of the feature of your upper motor neuron lesion. Okay. And what are these extra pyramidal tracts? So the extra pyramidal tracts are parallel tracts, okay, which are very much parallel to your pyramidal tracts. Again, they have multiple connections from the brain, multiple networks. They can come from the frontal lobe. They can come from the basal ganglia. They can relay through the thalamus. They can come through some nuclei in the midbrain called as the red nucleus. They can relay from the cerebellum. So these are called extra. In extra, you know, it means in addition. Okay, so they are like a supportive cast to the pyramidal tract. But one of the feature of extra pyramidal tract is that it is much more diffuse than a pyramidal tract. A pyramidal tract is much more targeted, you know, opposite side of the body to the distal hand motor functions or the distal leg functions. Okay, whereas your extra pyramidal tract function is much more diffuse, and that's why it controls your posture. It controls mainly your truncal muscles. So one of the important concepts that you need to understand is that your extra pyramidal tract is very diffuse, okay, and it does not localize itself into ipsilateral side or contralateral side, okay, though for basic anatomical purposes, most of the extrapyramidal lesions are also contralateral. For example, if you have a right basal ganglia lesion, you would have a problem in the left side of the body. But primarily, you should know is that the extrapyramidal tract affects the tone. So if you see a child who is having a poor tone or a poor balance, okay, or he seems to be a little bit floppy, one of the major reasons is that the extrapyramidal tract is involved. And another important thing about this extrapyramidal tract is that it is involved in your sequence of movements. It is involved in your direction of movements. It is involved in your force of movements. Okay. And if your sequence, direction, force, everything is lost, you have unwanted movements or intrusive movements. Okay. So if you see a child or cerebral palsy child with unusual movements, okay, or fidgety movements, okay, unusual twisting postures, poor direction, poor accuracy of movements, always think about a extrapyramidal tract dysfunction. Okay, so whenever you see a neurological child, one of the things that we neurologists ask students to train the mind is to think anatomically. So if you see a speech problem, think anatomically, where could be the problem? If you see a movement disorder, again, think anatomically, where is the problem? Okay, so two summaries, that if a child has a basic hand function issues, it could be in the pyramidal tract, and if your child has a basic postural tone or a truncal tone, okay, or the axial, the midline tone issues, okay, think about extrapyramidal tract and unwanted movements, think about your extrapyramidal tract. Okay. So another important concept why there should be abnormal movements is that the sequence of developmental maturation is very, very abnormal in a child with cerebral palsy. Okay. So I'm sure you would have classes with the developmental pediatrics. There would be some other doctors would be teaching you about the developmental sequence of brain maturation in children. Okay. So that's the reason I'm not going into too much details, but what you should understand is that the sequence, okay. For example, what is the normal sequence? A child should first have neck control. Okay. And then the child should sit, and then the child should stand, and then the child should walk. This is a sequence. Okay. And if you look at a child with a cerebral palsy, some of the mothers are very happy. They say, oh my God, my child has have a very good neck control and my child is able to actually stand before sit. What has happened is that the child neck is controlled because of an unusual extensor muscle, neck extensor muscle hypertonia. Okay. And the child is able to stand before sitting because of a back muscle hypertonia. So there is an absolute chaos in the sequence. You know, the child could able to stand before sitting. Okay. And this sort of change in the sequence is called a developmental deviance. Okay. There is a deviation from the normal sequence. Okay. So whenever you see this a deviation from the normal sequence of developmental maturation, again, you should think about cerebral palsy. So this developmental maturation contributes to unusual movements in children with cerebral palsy. This particular slide is very important. So whenever there is one important slide, probably I have it put an asterisk signs. Okay?
It's 8 o'clock.
Not in this one, but as you see, children would have something called in utero reflexes or a fetal reflexes called primitive reflexes like Moro's reflexes and asymmetric tonic neck reflexes. These are in utero reflexes, meaning by they start inside the fetus. Okay. And they help in the proper, you know, sequence of the development. So generally all these primitive reflexes, as you can see in these images, starts to disappear by around 6 months of age. And at around the same time, you have the balancing reflexes called postural reactions or postural reflexes starts to appear. So this is the normal sequence of a development. The primitive reflexes disappear and the postural reflexes appear. Okay. But what happens in cerebral palsy is that primitive reflexes do not disappear. They tend to persist for a longer time and postural reflexes appear either very late or they do not appear. So there is a change in the sequence. Okay. Like if you have unusual primitive reflexes like Moro's or ATNR's or GRASP or STNR, okay, it can also produce intrusive movements. So generally remember, normally most of these primitive reflexes disappears by 6 to 7 months of age. Okay. So this is one important slide. I have put an asterisk. So whenever I have an important slide, I put an asterisk sign. Okay. Which means the examiner may ask and question you about the persistent primitive reflexes. Okay. He may ask you about more details about Moro's reflex, ATNR reflex, GRASP reflex, and so on. Okay. So what is just Moro's reflex? I'm sure all of you would know Moro's reflex is a vestibular reflex. Okay. When you drop the neck of the child, like you can see in this video. Okay. This examiner just drops the neck of the child, there will be a sudden abduction, extension, and opening of the hands. Over here, you can see there is a sudden abduction. Just gently drop the neck. It's a vestibular reflex because of vestibular nuclei in the ear. There's an abduction, extension, and opening of the hand. So this primitive reflex in a CP child can be seen even at 2 years of age or 3 years of age. Okay. And because of this unusual primitive reflexes, the child will not be able to do a proper developmental sequence in the developmental milestones. Okay. Right. So one of the questions that the examiner can ask you is that when does a Moro's reflex start and when does a Moro's reflex disappears and so on. Okay. We'll see to that later. Just see about this asymmetric tonic reflexes. This is another primitive reflexes. So one thing students should remember here is that if your primitive reflexes persist, okay, it impairs your normal sequence of your developmental milestones. Just imagine a child is doing like this, a fencing posture. Okay. When they turn the neck, how can this child turn over? The child cannot turn over to this side, to the left side. If whenever the child tries to turn to the left side, this hand will impair turning to the left side because the hand becomes stiff. So this is otherwise a normal reflex, which is seen somewhere around 1 month maximum and disappears around 5 months of age or 5 to 6 months of age. Okay. But in a case of cerebral palsy, this will persist. And because the ATNR persists, the child will not able to, you know, roll over and not able to turn over and not able to creep or crawl. It will impair the creeping, crawling, and rollover. So a persistent primitive reflexes can cause unusual movements, and a persistent primitive reflexes can impair the sequence of a normal developmental gain in milestones. Okay. So this is a very important concept. And another thing that the examiner usually could ask is that what is the sequence of disappearance of a primitive reflexes? So when I used to do my PGDMS, PGI teacher, I used to tell this mnemonic. So those of you who are interested in mnemonic, you can remember this. The order of disappearance for primitive reflexes. I used to tell this mnemonics for remembering MCQs, okay? So reflexes will go mostly to AP. AP means Andhra Pradesh. So this is the order of disappearance of reflexes. The reflexes that first go are, so R is your rooting reflexes, it disappears around 2 months of age. W is your walking reflexes disappears at 2 months. G is your palmar grasp reflexes. So when you touch the ulnar aspect, the child will grasp the pen, okay? And that disappears around 3 months of age. Morris reflexes, just what we saw, a phase of abduction and adduction and, you know, opening of the hands, that disappears around 5 months of age. ATNR or asymmetric tonic neck reflexes usually disappears in around 6 months of age. And plantar grasp aspect, if you touch the plantar aspect of the sole, there will be like plantar flexion of the toes, okay? And that disappears around 9 months of age. Just imagine what would happen if the plantar grasp does not disappear, okay? So what is the importance of a plantar grasp? Whenever the child touches the floor, okay, the toes goes into flexion. So how can a child walk when the plantar grasp is still active? The moment the child keeps the leg on the floor, the toes goes into the flexion, okay, and it will impair the further walking. So that is the importance of primitive reflex. So whenever you have a primitive reflex, it prevents the maturation of sequence of the next milestones, okay? So like ATNR prevents rollover, plantar grasp persistence prevents walking. I'm sure it's clear here, okay? Because this is a very important concept. You should know the order of disappearance of primitive reflexes, okay, could be asked in your exams. The child will not be able to assume normal posture. For example, if you need to sit, you need to balance yourself. This is called as a lateral propping reaction. So if you gently push a child who's around 6 to 7 months of age, he will be able to take this hand and support himself. So children with cerebral palsy will not be able to do this. This is called as a lateral propping reaction, okay? And if you take a child and, you know, push downwards as if you're going to make the fall down, like, for example, if you take a cat and throw from the fourth floor of the building, nothing happens to the cat. The cat gently, you know, comes down. It's because it has a good parachute or like flying like reflexes, okay? And this reflex comes around 9 months of age and it persists. Children with cerebral palsy, this reflex do not appear, or if they appear, they tend to appear very late. So you understand that because of loss of primitive reflexes persistence of primitive reflexes and absence of posture reflexes, there are unusual movements or are abnormal quality of movements in children with cerebral palsy. So to summarize, these are the movement impairment you can see in a cerebral palsy. So I again and again emphasize, cerebral palsy is a disorder of movement and posture. Okay. So in a child with cerebral palsy, you can observe increased movements. In a child with cerebral palsy, you can observe decreased quality of movements. Okay. This is again important. Decreased quality. The child is not moving like other child. A free-flowing movement. Okay. Just imagine a child who's like 4 months or 5 months, you know, playing and cooing and babbling in the bed. The child will do this free swatting movements. Okay. As if he's like swatting the flies. Okay. This is called fidgety movements. A child with a cerebral palsy will not have this fidgety movements. You know, they don't easily move their hands up and down. Okay. So they have decreased quality of movements. A child with cerebral palsy is unable to perform a normal intended movements. He's not able to take the hand and reach the target. A child with cerebral palsy would have unwanted intrusive movements. Okay. So all these things are very important concepts. And some of the increased movements that you can have are chorea, dystonia, and athetosis. Okay. So what is chorea? Chorea is... Yeah. So what is chorea? Chorea is a flowing movement. Dystonia is a twisting postures. And athetosis are small, writhing, worm-like movements. Okay. What are these decreased movements? You can have decreased movements because of increased stiffness because of a pyramidal tract dysfunction. You can have increased stiffness when there is a basal ganglia damage causing a very stiff muscle known as rigidity. You should know the difference between a spasticity and a rigidity, right? So you can have a spasticity or a rigidity, or some cases of a basal ganglia damage can cause bradykinesia like a Parkinson's syndrome. Okay. A child is not able to perform a good quality intended movements because of a non-development of a postural reflex. So the postural tone or balance is lost. The child would have unwanted intrusive movements because of a persistent primitive reflexes. Okay. So this is the concepts of understanding how the movement quality is impaired in a child with cerebral palsy. So just see this video. This child is having this, flowing movements or dancing movements. He's keeping on dancing. He's not steady. You know, he's keeping on writhing the fingers. So there is some atytosis. He's like jerking, okay? And his like trunk is like almost like twisting again and again. So what is the definition of chorea? Chorea is sudden, random, arrhythmic flowing movements, okay? Arrhythmic flowing movements. So the two keywords are, it's not rhythmic because a tremor is a rhythmic, okay? It's a arrhythmic flowing movements. So if you see this side of a chorea, you should always try to know that this is probably because of a basal ganglia damage, gives a clue regarding a dyskinetic cerebral palsy. And if you see like this sort of a arching posture, twisting posture, see the child of the hand, it is like twisted backwards, okay? So the key word is here is twisted. It is not only stiff, but it's also twisted, okay? Neck twisting, okay, hand twisting, leg twisting. It's again a clue for a dyskinetic cerebral palsy, or this is known as dystonia. So in this video, again, you can see how much this child is having, you know, the hands are kept like this. See the way his necks are twisted and contoured, okay? There is like arrhythmic, sometimes sustained, sometimes intermittent twisting postures, okay? So dystonia is not only stiffness, but in addition to stiffness, there is a lot of twisting. So this is a child with a bilirubin-induced brain injury or a dyskinetic cerebral palsy, okay? So whenever you see a chorea or a twisting postures like dystonia, always think about a dyskinetic or a basal ganglia injury or an extrapyramidal injury. I told you, extrapyramidal symptom causes unwanted movements, okay? Pyramidal tract impairs your hand function, okay? So this gives an idea about your extrapyramidal impairment CP or a dyskinetic CP. So whenever you see a child who's so stiff that his legs have undergone scissoring, okay? It is so stiff because of the adductor muscles have become so stiff, so the legs undergo crossing like this. You should think about a spastic type of a cerebral palsy. He's not even able to take the legs and move other side because of the stiffness. Okay, so stiffness or scissoring is a feature of your pyramidal tract dysfunction, and it's a feature of your pyramidal tract injury cerebral palsy or a spastic cerebral palsy. Right. So the first concept is a very important concept. CP is a movement disorder. So you have to know what is a movement disorder. Is that a pyramidal movement disorder affecting your hand motor function? Or is it an extrapyramidal movement disorder affecting your posture and causing unwanted movements? You can see increased movements like chorea, dystonia, okay, and atytosis. You can see decreased movements like spasticity and rigidity. There is a poor postural control causing impaired movements, okay, and there is a persistent reflex causing unwanted intrusive movements, okay. I'm sure I'm clear with the concepts here, right? Next slide, okay. So there are many types of palsies in cerebral palsies, okay. So again, an important for the exam point of view, how do you understand the different types of impairments in cerebral palsy? In addition to movement, the next important thing that is impaired in the cerebral palsy is the posture. So the tone and the posture and the balance, all three things together are affected. Let's see them about them. Okay. So palsy means that I'm not able to perform because of an impaired motor function. And as you know, that multiple motor impairment can be seen in a child with cerebral palsy. Okay. And multiple motor impairment can affect your tone, can affect the power, can affect your primitive reflexes and postural reflexes. Okay, again, the same concept. So if you go in a sequence of examination, in motor examination, you check the tone and you check the power. Always never forget to check the primitive reflexes and the postural reflexes. So your tone and your power and your postural reflexes, ultimately, what does it goes? Ultimately, it affects your movement and your posture. So this is the definition of cerebral palsy. So cerebral palsy, movement is affected because of tone changes, power changes, pyramidal tract dysfunction and extrapyramidal tract dysfunction, okay? Posture is affected because of your tone changes, motor changes, power changes, okay? And unusual primitive reflexes and postural reflexes, okay? It is the same thing again and again, same cycle, but be careful about them. Let us now focus about the tone changes in a cerebral palsy. So in terms of tone, how do you divide a cerebral palsy or how do you classify a cerebral palsy? So I'm sure all of you know this. If a tone is very tight, you call it as hypertonia. And if the tone of the child or the feel of the child is very less, you call it as hypotonia, okay? So both can be seen in cerebral palsy, okay? And in addition to this, if the tone is like variable, keeps on changing time to time, you call it as a dyskinetic cerebral palsy. So based upon the tone, you divide it into three types, spastic, dyskinetic, and ataxic. Spastic, rigid, dyskinetic, and ataxic, okay? How do you define cerebral palsy on based on the distribution of the weakness? On distribution of the weakness, if one side of the body is affected, you call hemiplegia. If the legs are more affected, you call diplegia. And if all the four limbs are affected, you call quadriplegia. So based upon the distribution, you call as hemiplegia, diplegia, and quadriplegia. So this is the basic classification of cerebral palsy. based upon tone, you call it as spastic. Okay, so you can have a spastic hemiplegic cerebral palsy, or you can have a spastic diplegic cerebral palsy, or you can have a spastic quadriplegic cerebral palsy. And based upon the tone, you can also call it as dyskinetic. So you can have a dyskinetic, also quadriplegic cerebral palsy, and you can have an ataxic, also quadriplegic cerebral palsy. Okay, so this is the basic classification of cerebral palsy. So students should know what does spasticity means, what does rigidity means, okay, what does hemiplegia means, what does diplegia means, and what does quadriplegia means very clearly. And that is the reason cerebral palsy is an exam case. Okay, so this again is a image to show that if one half of the brain or the pyramidal tract is affected, for example, your left pyramidal tract is affected, you have a right-sided hemiplegia. Okay, and if your periventricular tract and your midline of your brain is affected, okay, you have your diplegia. If multiple areas of your brain is affected, you have quadriplegia. If your basal ganglia is affected, you have a dyskinetic cerebral palsy. It could be choreoathetosis, like we show in the video, or it can be a dystonia with a sustained or twisting postures. Okay, if your basal ganglia is affected, if your cerebellum is affected, you have a ataxic type of cerebral palsy. Okay, so this is a normal basic classification of cerebral palsy. So what is a tone? A tone is an intrinsic resistance offered by the muscles. Okay, so you assess the tone by feeling the muscles. Muscles is like rubber, muscle is like hard, like a stone. Okay, and it is the resistance offered when you move the joint. Okay, like in an orthopedic examination, you move the joint and see the range of motion across the joint. So if your muscles are stiff or your tone is changed because of either loss of upper motor neuron or loss of lower motor neurons, your range of motion is affected. Your range of motion can either increase or decreases. So what is tone? Tone is your intrinsic resistance offered by the muscles, and the resistance that you feel when you do a range of motion across the joints. Okay, so this tone is variable in different types of cerebral palsy, and you need to understand by doing a proper examination. As I've already told before, the loss of upper motor control causes activation of your lower motor anterior horn cell and gamma motor neurons, causing spasticity, okay, and unusual tone. So tone changes in CP can have high tone hypertonia, can have a low tone hypotonia, or can have a variable tone. Sometimes you feel the tone is increased, sometimes you feel the tone is decreased, and this is very unique in a child with dyskinetic cerebral palsy. So you should understand that tone is also beneficial and sometimes harmful. Okay, so it is not that every time a tone is bad. For example, if a child is having a good truncal tone or extensor hypertonia, if a child is having a good extensor hypertonia, okay, that helps in the child standing, that helps in the child to walk. But sometimes if you tone can harmful, because a sustained increase in tone can cause, you know, stiffness across the joint, and over a long term it can produce, and over a long term it can produce contractures across the joint. Okay, a tone can also helps in improvement of the balance of the trunk. So this is a decision where a neurologist takes when giving medicines to reduce the tone. If you reduce the tone too much, it can affect the balance, and sometimes a child who was able to walk with an increased back tone suddenly will not be able to walk because you have reduced the tone with the help of anti-spasticity medication. So that is a balance you have to not too much to reduce the tone as well. You need just that amount of tone which could help the child to walk. So how do you check for tone? You check by doing a range of motion. Okay, so this is one good photo which shows that how do you keep your hands. Okay, to check the range or motion across the knee joint, you keep one hand in the popliteal fossa and one hand just below the ankle. Okay, and you give a sudden rapid jerky thrust. That's the catch point. Okay, so first you give a sudden rapid thrust and see what happens here. So you can do this same motion in a slow motion also. So if you do the same motion in the slow motion, you will feel a different type of tone changes. And if you do the same maneuver very fast, you will feel a different type of resistance offered by the joint. Okay, so both these are very, very important. I repeat again, when you do this particular type of movement, and when you give a rapid movement or a fast thrusty movement, okay, and if you feel a resistance offered, then it is most likely spasticity. But if you do this type of, you know, flexion at the knee joint very slowly, and when you do slowly, and then at that point when you are feeling a resistance offered across the joint, then it is most likely rigidity. So that is a basic difference between a spasticity and a rigidity. And the way to understand that is to change the velocity of your flexion or extension across the joint. Okay, so this is what an examiner should do. He should do it slow and he should do fast, and then he should appreciate the resistance offered across the joint. Okay, So this is the basic difference between spasticity and rigidity. An examiner would definitely ask you, a spasticity is much appreciated if you move the joint rapidly or if you give a sudden thrust across the joint. And what you feel is like a clasp knife phenomena. Okay, it is just like a knife. When you are breaking, there is a sudden catch or sudden release at the joint. Okay, so if you feel a clasp knife like phenomena, then it is a spasticity. Okay, and it is velocity dependent, because if you do more faster, you are likely to appreciate a spasticity. Spasticity always have pathological reflexes like Babinski sign. Okay, the extensor toe becomes extensor when you do a Babinski maneuver. Okay, and the reflexes are brisk and you can get an ankle clonus. What happens in a rigidity? In a rigidity, if you do a fast movement, you will not be able to appreciate the rigidity. But if you do it very slowly, you will feel as if you are bending a lead pipe. Okay, this is a lead pipe or like an aluminium pipe. If you sort of bend it, you will feel that resistance offered continuously. So in a case of a rigidity, you would feel a continuous or a constant resistance being offered across the joint, and that is called as a lead pipe phenomena. Okay, and the way to do it is to slowly bend a joint. There is no pathological reflex, like no clonus. The reflexes are normal. Okay, there is no Babinski, and rigidity happens because both the agonist and the antagonist muscles are involved equally. So, and another point examiner would ask is that why there is a differential involvement in spasticity. Okay, differential involvement in spasticity is because of the way the pyramidal tract works. Okay, the way the pyramidal tract is usually more active in the flexors of the upper limb and the extensors of the lower limb. Okay, and that's why the loss of pyramidal tract dysfunction causes more spasticity in the flexors of the upper limb and extensors of the lower limb. So that's a differential involvement, and that's a differential spasticity noted. And this is the differential spasticity is the reason for which you have this characteristic postures. Okay, like you have a like hand bent like this, adducted. Okay, flexed at the elbow, flexed at the wrist. Okay, with the pronation, and flexed at the thumb. These unusual postures is because of the differential involvement of muscles in a case of upper motor system. Okay, whereas in an extrapyramidal system, it sort of supplies both the agonist and the antagonist in a equal way. So both the agonist and the antagonist are affected. Okay. So how does the tone changes? You should understand that even though the upper motor dysfunction causes spasticity or hypertonia, initially because of the brain maturation, most of these children would have hypotonia. This is another important concept. Okay. So if a child has an hypotonia, does not mean that the child does not have a spastic CP. So the initial 6 months is very tricky. Sometimes you see only hypotonia, but later on, after the first 6 months, most of these children start developing hypertonia, unless if the CP is so severe, okay, that it destroys almost 95% of the brain injury, then you can have very early hypertonia. So most of the cerebral palsy children would have a phase of hypotonia in the first 6 months, okay? And then gradually, as the pyramidal tracts get matured, okay, there is more dysfunction, more disinhibition, leading to your hypertonia and spasticity. So in a case of an extrapyramidal CP, they characteristically go through these three phases. Initially, they are hypotonic for the first 4 months, and then they have a lot of arching, called as a dystonic phase on opisthotonies or arching of the back, and then they have an hypertonic phase. Okay, so a dyskinetic phase would have lot of opisthotonus or neck arching in the first 1 year of life. Okay, that's a clue. That's why this is mentioned in Arachami, in Opiga, everything. Okay, so if you see a child is too much of arching the back in the neck in the infancy, it's a clue. It's a probably a dyskinetic type of a cerebral palsy. So all of you like mnemonics. So one easy way to remember a spastic CP is to remember the term spastic itself. Okay. So what are the features of a spastic cerebral palsy? There is hypertonia. There is clasp knife phenomena. So there is S for scissoring of limb. They have more seizures. Okay. So spastic CP have more seizures. Almost 1/3 children can have more seizures. And if a child is quadriplegic and spastic, they have more motor deficits. P for persistent primitive reflexes. And P for posture is impaired. And these children, even though they have a limb spasticity, they have some degree of truncal hypotonia. Okay. And A is absence of cortical sensory signs, very typically seen in children with the hemiplegia. If you give them some coin in the affected limb, okay, and ask them to close their eyes and ask them to say what is there inside their hands, they will not be able to appreciate. This is called as asteriognosis. Okay. They can have apraxia, they can have visual agnosia, they can have anopsias. Okay. So they can have all related to ace, apraxia, agnosia, asteriognosis. Okay. They can have asymmetry of limb size, right? They can have asymmetry of their toenail size, asymmetry of their thumbnail size. They can have sensory impairment, they can have speech impairment, which is very severe in quadriplegics. Their tone is increased. They can have toe walking in diplegics. You can have a thumb fisting. This is called as a cortical thumb fisting or Crutchley sign. Okay. Intellectual disability is much more severe in a quadriplegics. You can see a clasp knife phenomena of spasticity elicited by sudden jerking of the limbs. You can see an ankle clonus. Okay. So these are the important features in a spastic cerebral palsy. Okay. So those who remember mnemonics to remember. Remember spasticity, scissoring, thumb fisting, clonus. Okay. Tone is increased on these important features. So which is the most commonest type of cerebral palsy? It is spastic type of cerebral palsy. So almost 80% of cerebral palsy is spastic type of cerebral palsy. Okay. And why this is very common? Because of more injury to the white matter and pyramidal tracts, because we have more and more preterm children who have been, you know, resuscitated and who have been having long NICU stays. If you take like to 30 years ago, a lot of these preterm babies never used to survive. But because of advances in medical care, there is increase in the, you know, increase in the survival rate of preterm babies, and that automatically increases some degree of disability in children. So spastic cerebral palsy is the commonest type of cerebral palsy. Okay. So another easy way to remember dyskinetic. So all of you saw a dyskinesia is a when you have a predominant extrapyramidal type of brain injury. So I told you about extrapyramidal. Okay, the truncal tone is impaired. There are a lot of unwanted movements. There is a basal ganglia injury. In a dyskinetic cerebral palsy is not very common, luckily, because these days there is a good treatment for neonatal jaundice, okay, and kernicterus. But even these days, dyskinetic cerebral palsy can happen if there is a very severe birth asphyxia, which damages your thalamus and basal ganglia. So in a dyskinetic cerebral palsy, so what is the predominant mode of injury? It is a basal ganglia type of injury. And what do you predominantly say? You see predominant impaired movements, like you see impaired movements like dystonia, which means twisting postures. You see dyskinesia like chorea, which means flowing postures. Because your bilirubin injury can impair your cochlear nuclei, you can see deafness if there was a bilirubin induced basal ganglia injury. Some of these children can be yellow at birth. The speech is slow and monotonous, like an extrapyramidal speech or a Parkinson's speech. Okay, if there was a severe birth asphyxia, there is something called as status maromaratus or marble-like brain injury of the brain. I will tell you about this later, okay, when I talk about brain injury. One of the main etiology was kernicterus brain injury. But these days, please remember, the maximum dyskinetic brain cerebral palsy is because of severe birth asphyxia damaging the thalamus and the basal ganglia, and not because of kernicterus brain injury. Okay, the intellectual capacity can be normal. Okay, especially in children with dyskinetic chorea or thetoid cerebral palsy, intellectual capacity can be normal. You can see increased ATNR reflexes and primitive reflexes. The tone is reduced in the first 4 to 6 months of age. You can see extrapyramidal system, which is the most affected. Eye movements of the supra gaze is affected. Okay, so that's important to know. Okay, they can have some degree of supranuclear gaze palsy. Okay. Again, because of your basal ganglia involvement affecting your eye coordination. Okay. They can have a teeth enamel hyperplasia, especially if it's because of jaundice, because severe bilirubin affects your teeth enamel, and you can have a green color teeth, as you can see here. Okay. After severe. So this is one clue. If you do a good proper examination, if you get this finding, okay, get this finding in the teeth, check the teeth also, then you know that is a dyskinetic type of cerebral palsy. These children are extremely irritable as a neonate, and they can have C for choreocytosis or cogwheel rigidity. Okay, so these are some of the key features of a dyskinetic cerebral palsy. So we focused upon the examination. I told you about the tone. You can have spasticity where there is a catch clasp knife phenomena, rigidity where there is a lead pipe like rigidity. We talked about dyskinetic cerebral palsy, both dystonic cerebral palsy and a choreothetoid cerebral palsy. Okay, now let's focus upon the distribution of weakness, that is between hemiplegia, diplegia and quadriplegia. Okay, so which is the commonest cerebral palsy? It is a spastic diplegic cerebral palsy. Okay, again, I repeat, which is the commonest cerebral palsy? It is a spastic diplegic cerebral palsy, primarily because more and more preterm children are getting survived, and because of improved quality of care, these preterm children are more prone to have injury to their white matter, okay, or their pyramidal tracts. And so we have more of spastic diplegia. So what is the hemiplegia? So examiner is keen for you to to say the posture. He will ask you, describe the posture of hemiplegia. Okay. So you should be able to describe the posture of hemiplegia. Now, all of you know, in this child with a right-sided hemiplegia, the lesion is from the left side of the brain. And how do you describe this posture? This posture, as I told you, the flexors of the upper limb are affected and the extensors of the lower limb are affected. So what you see is a typical posture is that the shoulder is adducted. Okay, there is flexion at the elbow, there is flexion at the wrist, there is pronation, okay, and there is a flexion at the thumb or a thumb fisting, and there is a plantar flexion, and there is a knee flexion, and there is a hip flexion. So you have a posture with a, almost like an equinus posture. This is like called as equinus. Equinus means like a horse toe. Equinus posture is because of knee flexion, hip flexion, and a plantar flexion. So this is like a triple flexion causing this particular equinus like posture. Okay, so the hemiplegic CP are those CPs because of an old insult to one side of the brain. Okay, most of them are because of in utero stroke. Okay, they have absolutely good prognosis. All these children walk, most of these children walk by 2 years, and definitely 100% walk by 4 years of age. They have the best prognosis, but only one issue they can have is that they can have convulsions. They can have a focal epilepsy because there is a brain injury on one side of the brain. Okay. They can go to school. Okay. It's not a bad CP at all. Okay. And like any hemiplegia, like you can get all the signs of hemiplegia in this side. So you can have a brisk reflexes in this side, and you can have an extensor Babinski on this side. So what do you mean by a diplegic CP? A diplegic CP means the legs is more affected than the hands. A diplegic CP does not mean legs alone affected. Okay. So that is one very, very important concept. In a diplegic CP, also the hands are affected to a mild degree, but the legs are very severely affected. Okay. So where do you see the diplegic CP? You see a diplegic CP in a preterm child. Okay. And what is the prognosis? The prognosis is not bad, good. Okay. Most of the children can walk by 4 years. Okay. Some children may take some time up to walking by 7 years. Okay. And they have primarily motor disability. Intellectual disability is variable. 50% have normal IQ. Okay. Those who have severe degree of PBL can have some degree of intellectual impairment. Okay. And the posture is equinus. As you can see, there will be bilateral plantar flexion. Okay. There'll be some degree of knee flexion, and there'll be some degree of hip flexion. Okay. So what is a quadriplegic CP? Invariably, the quadriplegic CP is the most severe type of CP. If you have a very severe type of brain injury or a diffuse brain injury, okay, involving the pyramidal tracts and the extrapyramidal syndrome, okay, together, or a diffuse cortical and pyramidal tract involvement, thalamus injury, okay, you have a quadriplegia. So quadriplegia child would have spasticity arms. The upper limbs are more affected than the lower limbs. So this is another important point. In a quadriplegia, the upper limbs are more affected than the lower limbs. Again, you can have the elbow flexure. Okay. You can have the some degree of extension. So the postures are quite variable depending upon the degree of contractures a particular joint produces. So the student should just see the child and describe the posture as they see the child. Okay. Now, do they walk? Most of them do not walk. Okay. Most of them do not walk, but 2 out of 10 children can walk by 7 years, especially if they are able to sit by 4 years. Okay. So if you want to write it somewhere, you write it. A child with quadriplegic CP, if they are able to sit without support by 4 years, they can still walk by 7 years. Okay. So one of the big advice that we give to parents is that they need to keep trying with physiotherapy and rehabilitation by till 4 years. So if a child can sit by 4 years, you know, there is a significant chance that these children can still walk. So you should push them for doing physiotherapy. You should not say, just leave it. Nothing can be done. But these are the children who have a lot of comorbidities. Okay. Almost 50% can have epilepsy. They have feeding issues. They have drooling issues, speech issues, and they have worst degree of prognosis. So all these three types are very important: hemiplegia, diplegia, and quadriplegia. The worst prognosis is with quadriplegia. The best prognosis is with hemiplegia, and diplegia have a prognosis somewhere in between. So as you know, an impaired tone, whether it is spasticity or dystonia, and your impaired power, whether it is hemiplegia, quadriplegia, or diplegia, ultimately affects the posture of the child and gait of the child. What do you mean by the posture? Posture is your attitude. Okay. How do I look when I sit? How do I look when I stand? How do I look when I walk? Okay. All of us, most of you go to gym and you want to have a good, nice posture. Okay. So if your tone is affected, if your power is affected, if your extrapyramidal system or pyramidal system is affected, ultimately it affects your posture and gait. Because you remember, what is the goal? Ultimately we walk, we want these children with cerebral palsy to walk at least by 7 years of age. So a posture or gait is affected by your abnormal tone, abnormal power, and abnormal movement. So all these things we had discussed this till this point. Okay. So let us have a look at abnormal postures in cerebral palsy and abnormal gait. Okay. So in fact, when a child first comes to you in the OPD or when you are first examining the child, the first thing that you focus by observing the child is the posture of the child and gait of the child. I repeat again, when a child comes to you in exams, the first thing that you observe, okay, or note down in your case sheet is the posture of the child and the gait of the child. So these are the some of the postures of the child. Okay, so this child, you can see a significant degree of a bent back because of truncal hypotonia. Now, why does a truncal hypotonia? Which system is affected? Pyramidal or extrapyramidal? Pyramidal or extrapyramidal? Can somebody write in the chat quickly? Why do you have truncal hypotonia? Pyramidal or extrapyramidal? Somebody write in the chat. I'm just waiting. Why that should be truncal hypotonia? Okay. I wish I had interacted with you. Nobody's writing. Extrapyramidal. Excellent. Okay. So pyramidal extrapyramidal system is the one which causes truncal hypotonia because extrapyramidal has your vestibulospinal and reticulospinal tracts and it affects your tone. Okay. So you have CPs with the truncal hypotonia and with the involvement of limb spasticity. So some degree of mixed cerebral palsies. This truncal hypotonia is more prominent. Okay. And this is a W splitting. This is because of a tightness in your thigh adductor muscles. Okay. This can be seen in a, especially in diplegic CP, in a preterm diplegic CP, you can see a adductor spasticity causing a W sitting posture. Okay. Right. And you can see the scissoring because of your pyramidal tract dysfunction causing adductor muscle tightness, causing scissoring of your limbs. And you can see this cortical thumb or cortical fisting. This is also called as Critchley sign, because of flexion of your thumb, okay, because of spasticity in the thumb. So you have to observe, if you, especially if you have a child less than 2 years, you have to look for cortical fisting. If you miss this finding, then it is a very bad point. In hemiplegics, you can have a unilateral thumb fisting, okay. And you have to observe the gait. So what do you see this gait? Okay, this is a child who has right-sided hemiplegia. Okay, so you will be asked to describe the gait. So what you see here, is that the upper limb is flexed, the wrist is flexed, the hands are pronated. Okay, there is abduction at the right thigh, and as you can see, the right thigh is just kept outside. You can see here. Okay, the right leg is kept. So there is a circumduction gait. Okay. The right thigh is abducted and there's a circumduction gait. There's some degree of, you know, flexion and rotatory swing at the right leg. So this is a typical hemiplegic gait. So what happens in a hemiplegic gait? In a hemiplegic gait, there's a circumduction at the thighs. The thighs are abducted, okay? And there is flexion at the level of the elbows and flexion at the level of the wrist, okay? With fisting at the thumbs. This is your hemiplegic gait. So this is your diplegic gait with equinus, okay? So you can see both of the toe walking. So it's like both of your gastrocnemius is very tight and there is like bilateral plantar flexion, okay, with flexion at the knee and flexion at the hip, causing a walking like a horse. How does a horse walk? And this type of gait is called as equinus gait. So what is the equinus gait? Equinus gait, there is a knee flexion, there is a hip flexion, and there is plantar flexion, triple flexion, hip flexion, knee flexion, plantar flexion, okay, along with some degree of scissoring because of adductor tightness. And this is your typical equinized gait seen in a spastic diplegia. So these are some degree of, you know, this is a unilateral equinized gait, okay, and the equinous gates get corrected when you put them. This is a unilateral equinous gait, it can be seen in hemiplegia, okay. And this is like a circumductory gait. You can see a unilateral equinous gait here, which gets corrected with the ankle foot orthosis. You can see an extreme degree of a bilateral equinous gait, okay, like walking like a horse, which gets corrected with the ankle foot orthosis. Okay, you can see again unilateral equinous gait, okay, which gets corrected with the orthosis. You can see again a unilateral equinous gait. So equinous gait is a plantar flexion, okay, with some degree of knee flexion and hip flexion. Okay, again you can see a bilateral equinous gait, which gets corrected with the ankle foot orthosis. Okay, so where do you see a equinous gait? Equinous gait in a, you can see either in a hemiplegic CP or you can see in a diplegic CP. Like you can see, this is a unilateral equinus seen in a hemiplegic CP, right? So what is this gait? Okay, the only difference here is that instead of plantar flexion, there is ankle dorsiflexion. Can you see this? Observe this. There is a degree of a posterior hip tilt. There is a knee flexion, but instead of a plantar flexion, there is an ankle dorsiflexion. Observe the ankle carefully. This is called as a crouch gait or a tiger gait. So equinus gait is a horse gait, Crouch gate is a tiger gate. Crouch gate is a tiger gate, okay, where as if it's a tiger is slowly walking and coming. There is some degree of a posterior pelvic tilt with a knee flexion and the ankle dorsiflexion. So where do you see this? You see in a diplegic CP who has not been treated, okay, after so many years, from a equinus gate, it changes into a crouch gate. Or sometimes if there is a surgical release at the ankle, okay, the ankle becomes weak and undergoes ankle dorsiflexion. So this is called as a crouch gate. So where do you see a crouch gate? You see in a diplegic CP after long time. So an equinus gate can change into a crouch gate. Or if there is a surgical release of bilateral gastrocnemius, your ankle can become weak and there undergoes an ankle dorsiflexion and you can have this crouch gate. Okay. So this is a jumping gate, another type of a equinus gate, okay, where there is some degree of jumping which is noted. It looks as if he's jumping and going. Okay. Here there is not much degree of knee flexion. Okay. The knees are a bit tight. So you see this degree of jumping like a gait. Again, seen in a spastic diplegia. Okay. It's a jumping gait. So these are some of the different types of gait that you can observe. So what is the difference between a crouch and a gait? In a jumping gait, there is a significant plantar flexion, a fixed plantar flexion, whereas in a crouch gait, there is an ankle dorsiflexion. In a crouch plate, there is an ankle dorsiflexion. I'm repeating again and again so that it goes into your mind. Okay. So there are various palsies in cerebral palsy. So you have listened to the most important part of this topic, the different type of neurological syndrome. So we talked about involuntary movements. We talked about hypertonia. We talked about hypotonia. We talked about primitive reflexes, morose reflexes, persistent ATNR. We said that there is no parachute. We said that there is no Landau reflex. There is no writing reaction. We said that there is changes in tone. Okay, you can have hypertonia, hypotonia. We saw the different types of hemiplegia, diplegia, quadriplegia, diplegia and preterm, hemiplegia because of interim babies. Okay, quadriplegia, which is very severe. And we saw different types of gait pattern. Okay, at least you should be able to appreciate equinus pattern, okay, and a hemiplegic gait pattern in your exams. So next, quickly, we'll see some important history taking methods, maybe next 10 minutes. So what, not all CP is because of birth asphyxia. This is very, very important concept. Okay. Because the moment you see CP, you think that something happened at birth. The child did not cry, you know, and that's the reason maybe oxygen was not given appropriately. There's some problem with the doctors. It's not like that. CP is because of remote asphyxia. A child who's supposed to have a CP would have asphyxia starting in the womb itself. And most of this process starts in your trimester, third trimester, okay, either in the early third trimester or in the late third trimester. So what, you know, all of you know what is a perinatal period. So your perinatal period starts from 22 weeks of gestation to 7 days postnatal period. Okay, so maximum asphyxias or remote asphyxias happen in the third trimester. And one more important point is that if a child is like genetically impaired or having some unknown inborn error of metabolism or genetic condition or a muscle disease or a nerve disease, those are the babies who are highly prone to have asphyxia inside the womb itself, because they are actually weak babies. They are like weak fetuses. Okay. So all those fetuses who are destined to have asphyxia would have asphyxia inside the womb itself or inside the womb, usually starting from the third trimester. Okay. So asphyxia can happen at any gestation. In utero asphyxia is more important than your perinatal asphyxia. And most of the asphyxia starts either in the late third trimester or in the early third trimester. Okay. And only very few asphyxia actually happen during the process of delivery. So your sentinel event is like your dangerous event or like a typical event where you can say, okay, this has happened and that's why the baby did not cry. Okay. Is not seen in 2 out of 10 children. Okay. Only in around 80% you will get a history of a sentinel event. So all kids who have sentinel events would have neonatal encephalopathy. So this is a very important concept. Okay. So even if you take the history, and if the history, the mother says the baby cried at birth. Okay. But still the child could have had birth asphyxia or in utero asphyxia or a remote asphyxia. How do you know that? You have to know that by asking the history for neonatal encephalopathy. Okay. This is very, very important concept. Okay. So what is this neonatal encephalopathy? So you should ask about the immediate newborn parade. Okay. So the child may not have cried at birth or may have cried at birth, but the child would be absolutely pathetic, okay? Would be absolutely pathetic and would have some signs like the child would be lethargic, the child would not feed properly, the child would be either excessively crying or not at all crying. The child could have seizures, okay? Or the child could have some tone changes, okay? The child should be having some breathing issues after birth. So if you had any of these issues, you should think about neonatal encephalopathy. I hope the students understood, okay? So even if you don't get a history of a birth asphyxia, if the child had a history of a neonatal encephalopathy, like feeding issues or like breathing issues or like seizures or like tone issues, okay, you should think about probably the child had in utero asphyxia or a remote asphyxia. So what are the features of neonatal encephalopathy? This is very important to know. Child being a poor feeder, child being excessive cry, okay, that is immediately after the birth, the first 7 days after the birth, okay. The child was born, according to the doctor, the Apgar score is 7 and 9, okay. But you see the child is having poor feeding, the child is having a poor tone, the child is having seizures, the child is having respiratory issues, the child is having apnea, then likely you should definitely assume then this child had some degree of neonatal asphyxia. So one way to remember this neonatal encephalopathy history is by a mnemonic called FAST, F-A-S-T. F means feeding issues, A means apnea, S means seizure, and T means tone changes. So if your child, newborn, had any of these FAST or the FAST symptoms in the first 7 days, you should assume that the child had some form of asphyxia. Okay, so that's very, very important to understand. Okay, right. So you can get indirect evidence of asphyxia by going for a good history. Okay, across various gestation, what happened in the first trimester, what happened in the second trimester, and what happened in the third trimester. So again, absolutely important from an MBBS student for you to take a good history. So if I was an examiner, I would have asked you, what did the history you took in the first trimester? What history you took in the second trimester and what in the third trimester? There are so many points, but the most important is that the first trimester history of torch in the mother, like fever or rash in the mother. In the second trimester, maternal risk factors like maternal hypertension or maternal PIH or maternal diabetes. And in the third trimester, again, history of maternal infection like maternal chorioamnionitis. Okay, so these are some of the high risk conditions in the mother or the placenta, which can affect your baby. So if you have a very bad placenta, a placental insufficiency, okay, which can happen with PIH or it can happen with your maternal infection or intrauterine infections, okay, that can cause your asphyxia in the newborn, okay. In addition to that, there can be exposures like radiation, smoking, alcohol, okay. In vitro pregnancy, in vitro fertilization is a high risk for having birth asphyxia and so on. So if at all, if you want to remember, please remember the red ones: torch infection, maternal hypertension, maternal chorioamnionitis. And by default, all babies who are preterm and low birth weight have a very high risk for birth asphyxia. So a very low birth weight CP have 50 times high risk of CP. Normally 3 out of 1,000 children born could have CP. But if it is a very low birth weight, less than 1,500 grams, the risk of CP increases by 50 times. So almost 100 out of 1,000 children who are very low birth weight can have cerebral palsy. Okay. So also remember this point, any weak fetuses due to genetic illness is more prone to have a fetal asphyxia. Okay. So this is the third point. Not all is because of a birth asphyxia. You should go back and look about in utero asphyxia or remote asphyxia. Next concept, which is just to know, good to know, is that different types of brain injury can cause different types of CP, okay? And the timing of the brain injury is incident. For example, if you had a first trimester brain injury, it produces brain malformations. If you had a third trimester brain injury, it usually affects your basal ganglia, okay? So the timing is also important and it can produce different types of brain injury, okay? But how can we doctors say, okay, this brain injury is absolutely bad, so your child will not walk? What is the importance of understanding this? The importance of understanding this is that for you to say this particular brain injury, the prognosis is absolutely bad. Okay. So some of the key areas, if affected, we know that the prognosis is absolutely bad. For example, if your thalamus is affected, if your posterior limb of internal capsule is affected, okay, it's very, very bad prognosis. Okay. If your brainstem, your pons, medulla, or your putamen is affected, you know that the prognosis is going to be bad. And also the timing of the brain injury can give an idea of different types of brain injury. Okay. So here you should know three patterns, which is mentioned in OPGA and ARCHAM and everything. This is called as periventricular leukomalacia. So the white matter is more susceptible to injury in the early third trimester. I repeat again, the white matter is more susceptible to be injury in the early third trimester, 23 weeks, 24 weeks, 25 weeks, 26 weeks. And that's why preterm babies would have more of white matter brain injury. And your pyramidal tracts passes across these white matter. And that's why these children have more of diplegia and the leg area fibers are more affected than their hand fibers. Okay. So where do you see a periventricular leukomalacia? you see a periventricular leukomalacia if there is a preterm child with white matter brain injury. And this is the most common type of brain injury in cerebral palsy. All MBBS students likes to know about what is the most common brain injury. So what is the most common brain injury in CP? It is a periventricular leukomalacia in a preterm child. So if you have a very bad brain injury, it's called as devastating brain injury. Can you see that? Almost all the brain is damaged. We have big cyst, okay? Only the thalamus and the brainstem is spared. This is called as a devastating brain injury or multicystic encephalopalacia. It happens in the late third trimester or near term, okay? And it's absolutely poor prognosis. These children never sit, never walk, okay? Because none of the brain is there. So with this imaging, even in the beginning, you can prognosis that the prognosis is going to be very bad. So the second brain injury is multicystic brain encephalomalacia. The third, which is important, is also called as marble-like brain injury or status marmorotus. Status marmorotus is what you see in a near fatal asphyxia. What do you mean by a near fatal asphyxia? Like just imagine there is a 2-year-old toddler, okay, who is playing in the bathroom and he suddenly falls down into the bathtub, the late actress Sridevi, he died, suddenly falling into the bathtub. So somebody gets suddenly asphyxiated, like a strangulation, okay, The key area that is affected is your thalamus. Here is the thalamus, okay, here's the thalamus and here is the putamen. Rest of the brain would look normal and also the internal capsule. So the three area which is affected are the putamen, the internal capsule and the thalamus. Sorry, I did not mention the internal capsule here. And if these three are affected, it's called a status marmorotus. What is status marmorotus? Putamen, thalamus, and posterior limb of internal capsule. Okay. And rest of the brain looks very normal, but still the outcome is going to be very bad. The prognosis is very bad, and the children do not work and do not walk. This is called a status marmorotus. Okay. So this is the tabular column. You can take a screenshot if you want. But what you should know is that spastic diplegia is because of periventricular leukomalacia, preterm child. Spastic quadriplegia is because of a multicystic encephalomalacia, bad prognosis. Dyskinetic cerebral palsy do not work is because of status marmorotus or a bilirubin damage, which damages your globus pallidus. Okay. And these are the different types of brain injury that you can see. The early bird gets the worm, which means you have to identify the children early so that you involve them to rehabilitation and they improve dramatically. So how can you help these children? Okay. Is by identifying early. How can you identify early? By being a very good observer. Okay. So a good student observes more, a good doctor observes more. Okay. So if you see a poor quality of movements in a child who's extremely irritable, whose child who's keep on arching, a child who's having primitive reflexes, which does not disappear by 6 to 7 months, you should think about, early cerebral palsy. So what are the early, if you identify early, the prognosis is going to be better because you're going to involve this child for rehabilitation and more likely these children can sit by 4 years. So this children can at least walk by 7 years of age. Okay. So what are the early markers of CP? Absolutely important question as far as exam is concerned. They would ask you this question. There would be thumb fisting. Okay. There would be like opisthotonus or arching. Okay. There would be persistent of primitive reflex. You can see early toe walking or early handedness. Okay. Children do not develop handedness before 2 years. If there is child is using only one hand, it means that the other hand is weak. You can have early microcephaly. Okay. You can have a poor visual fixation. Okay, a child who seems to be a bit autistic, not interested in you, irritable child or an apathetic child, okay? Stereotypic abnormal movements, okay? Not having a good quality movements, okay? All these things are clue for early markers for CP. So an examiner, if you are getting in Viva, would mostly ask this question, what are the early markers of CP before 2 years of age? So the early markers of CP before 2 years of age are early handedness, persistence of primitive reflexes, poor visual interaction, okay? Scissoring, toe walking, and so on, okay? Thumb fisting and so on. Okay. Right. CP children can live their life like any other children if there is no motor impairment. So I'm not going into details of this because this is more for the PGs to know how to prevent deformities. How can you do deformity correction? What is the orthopedic examination of a cerebral palsy? But just remember, if you don't treat equinus or don't treat spasticity, ultimately these children would have contractures and deformities like equinovarus. Okay. Like a fixed deformity, right? So how can you help these children? You can help these children, okay, right, by doing early rehabilitation, okay, and by referring for Botox or surgery. So one question is that when you should refer for Botox or surgery, you should try to refer children for Botox or surgery early, between 4 to 7 years of age, okay? If a child starts walking, but if a child is having some problem, Botox or surgery is considered somewhere between 4 to 7 years of age, okay? So why does deformity happens? Because if you go by the physiological concept, if there is a primary motor impairment like tone changes or power changes or balance changes, it causes a secondary deformity like contracture and deformity. And a secondary deformity in the addition causes adaptive mechanisms like unusual postures like scoliosis and makes this deformity permanent. Okay, like for example, if you have a gastrocnemius spasticity, if you don't treat it, it becomes a fixed ankle plantar flexion contraction, and ultimately this causes a knee hyperextension and a jumping type of a gait, and ultimately the child would have scoliosis and other deformities. Okay, so a deformity happens when you don't treat the primary problem. As simple as that, a deformity happens when you don't treat the primary problem. Okay, so another question that examiners may ask you is that where do you get the contractures? It is again because of differential involvement in the upper motor system. You have in the flexors of the upper limb and extensors of the lower limb. Okay, so you have the hip flexors, okay, hip adductors, knee flexors, okay, and ankle and plantar flexors. Okay, so it is because these flexors, the contractures happens primarily in the flexor group of the muscles. They are the hip flexors, the knee flexors, and the plantar flexors, okay, and they happen in the finger flexors and the wrist flexors and the pronators. Okay, so these are the areas where contractures are more common. So how do you identify contractures? It is by means of certain orthopedic tests like Thomas test, Duncan Ely test, Silver Scuole test. I'm not going into the details. You can ask your orthopedic teachers to teach them, or when you're having your orthopedic posting, you can go through the methods. How do you understand hip flexion contractures, knee contractures, and ankle contractures? Okay. But if you mention to your examiner that there is some degree of contractures, that is much more than enough. So another important concept is that not every child who is having a stiff is a cerebral palsy. So sometimes you can see children who are like very stiff, okay, and spastic and sometimes dystonic. And you see that you think the child is having cerebral palsy and you do an MRI brain. MRI brain is absolutely normal and you are stunned. Okay, what is the reason? Okay, with a normal MRI brain, child is showing a movement disorder like spasticity, chorea, dystonia. And that is the time you should think that that is not a cerebral palsy. And you should also think it is not a cerebral palsy, especially if there is a family history of cerebral palsy. You cannot have one family where there is one child is having cerebral palsy, another is having cerebral palsy, where the cousins are having cerebral palsy. Okay, so you think about these conditions which look like cerebral palsy, especially if the MRI is normal, or if there is a family history of cerebral palsy, or the child was normal till a period of point, okay, and then develops a motor impairment, like normal till 1.5 years, and then develops a diplegia, or then develops a paraplegia, or then develops a hemiplegia. And you also think about these children when there's an uncontrolled movement disorder or uncontrolled epilepsy. Okay, there are many conditions, but just remember about some IEMs called hereditary spastic paraparesis, in which the MRI is normal and it affects the legs and it can mimic a diplegic CP. This is one important slide, you can take a screenshot. Okay, sometimes your brachial plexus palsy is confused with hemiplegic CP. Okay, and quadriplegic CP can be seen in some metabolic conditions like leukodystrophy and sulfate oxidase defect. And dyskinetic CP can be seen in movement disorders like DOPA responsive dystonia, glutaric aciduria. Ataxic CP can be seen in genetic syndromes like Joubert syndrome and Angelman syndrome. Mitochondrial CP, hypotonic CP can be mimic mitochondrial disorder. Okay, so basically these are genetic and metabolic conditions. The details are not required, but at least remember, if you have a white matter genetic disorder called leukodystrophy, it can mimic a quadriplegic CP or a diplegic CP. If you have a movement disorder, genetic movement disorder called DOPA responsive dystonia, it can mimic a dyskinetic CP. If you have a genetic condition called hereditary spastic paraparesis, where there is family history of lower limb spasticity, it can mimic a diplegic CP. Okay, right. So focus on ability, not on disability. So you need to assess the activities of daily living. Okay, so this is another important concept. Not just the child is having spasticity or rigidity or dystonia. You should ask in the history what the child can do and what the child cannot do. Okay, is it clear? You should ask whether the child can walk, can eat, can take a bath, can feed himself, okay, can button, can unbutton. Okay, so if you ask these questions of activities of daily living, it is helpful in rehabilitation, because ultimately you want this child to participate in the society. So there are so many grades to grade the hand function, grade the balance, grade the sitting. But what all students know is that what are the functional grading for ambulation? Okay, so the last important concept, okay, for you to understand in this presentation is called GMFCS, which means Gross Motor Functional Classification System. Gross Motor Functional Classification System. Okay, there is no exception. All students should know this, okay, because we want a child who is here, okay, to reach here. We want a child who is 5 to reach 1. Okay, what is 1? One is a child who can participate in communicate activities. He can walk, he can play, you can go to school. A child with two can also participate in community, though he has some difficulty, okay? Some difficulty, he may have to wear a special shoes, okay? A child who's three, okay, is also a community participator, but he would need a walking sticks or a crutches, or he can use a wheelchair with his hands, okay? But gross motor level 4 cannot participate in the community. So students, please know, level number 1, 2 and 3 can participate in the community. Level number 4 cannot participate in the community because or they would need an help or they would need somebody like assisting them to participate in the community. But they can do some degree of walking with the help of a walking frame at home. Okay, and the GMFCS level 5 is absolutely non-ambulatory child with a significant truncal hypotonia. Even they cannot hold their neck and they require a continuous caregiver assistance. So 1, 2 and 3 can walk at home and community. Okay, so 4 can walk at home. So it's a home walker with assistance, but with help. Okay, GMFCS 4 can turn into FCS 3 with a good rehabilitation methods like surgical corrections, Botox and so and so. So your ultimate aim is that you have to make a 4 into 3, okay, and 3 into 2 and 1, okay. So this is the idea, but unfortunately children with 5 usually do not improve. There's absolutely less chance a child with 5 can become 4 or 3 or 2 or 1, okay. So what is 3? Up to 3 is a community walker. A 4 is a home walker with assistance. Okay, a 4 can be changed into 3 with good rehabilitation methods. Okay, so children with CP hate going to hospital for medical issues. Okay, so there are multiple medical issues. You can remember this mnemonic. Okay, maximum pain is seen in C with A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. They can have autism, they can have behavioral issues, they can have scoliosis, they can have epilepsy. Okay, so there are numbers for this, but you don't need this. Almost, you know, 1/3 have epilepsy, right? Almost 1 in 10 would have some degree of failure to thrive. Okay. Autism, 1 in 10 children with with CP could have autism. Pain is another issue which is ignored in children with CP. As you can see, a child with pain can be because of multiple reasons. It can be because of hip dislocation, okay? So whenever you see a child with CP with pain, always check the teeth, check the genitalia. It can have an UTI, okay? Or they can have a scoliosis or a hip dislocation. They can have a glaucoma. They can have a dental abscess. They can be having pain because of significant spasticity and so on. So there are multiple issues which can cause a child to CP to cry. Okay. So CP in child would love to participate in a social life. Okay. So it's a role of a pediatrician or a doctor to involve with a neurologist, with the orthopedician, with occupational therapist, with the neurosurgeon, okay, multiple people. So ultimately it is a teamwork which helps them to participate in the society, right? So there are the F word in CP, okay? There are a child with CP requires the F word. A child with CP requires to have fitness. A child with CP requires to have a good function. A child with CP needs friends. A child with CP needs family. And a child with CP needs to have fun. So the more you allow the child to participate in school and activities, the more is their quality of life. Okay. Please remember, CP does not mean a child is mentally retarded. Okay. So this is the last point I'm telling you, because most of you think CP is mentally retarded. No, a child who's extremely quadriplegic CP with status maromaritus or a devastating brain injury, of course, could have mental retardation, but most of the CPs can still go to school, participate in social activities. Okay. So there are too many technological advances. As we know, we are going towards the next decade. Okay, where there is a lot of use of computers, mobile phones, or robotics. Okay, all of them can help these children to participate in the community. Okay, so let's go back to our theme, right? So I did discuss with you in a detailed way, in a nutshell. But what I told you is from Opigai and Archwami only, but I put the order according to the sequence of understanding that CP is a movement disorder. CP is a postural disorder with various type of palsies. Various type of palsies affects the posture in a CP. Not all cerebral palsies, because from remote asphyxia, you can have in utero asphyxia. Chorioamnionitis, low birth weight are very important risk factors. Different types of brain injury can cause different types of CP. There are three types of brain injury: periventricular leukomalacia in a preterm, status maromaritus in severe asphyxia, and multicystic encephalomalacia in a term HIE. Okay, early bird gets the worm. So you have to early identify the CP before 2 years of age. If you have morosine, if you have a thumb fisting, if you have scissoring, if you have toe walking, if you have early handedness, you should identify your CP. Life is better if there is no progressive impairment. So you should refer these children for Botox between 4 to 7 years. You should prevent deformities with a good rehabilitation. Beware of the mimics. Three mimics you should remember is leukodystrophy, hereditary spastic paraparesis, and DOPA responsive dystonia. I remember. I repeat, three mimics you should remember is DOPA responsive dystonia for dyskinetic CP, leukodystrophies for quadriplegic and diplegic CPs, and hereditary spastic paraparesis for diplegic CPs. You should focus on the ability, okay, CP, you should manage the medical issues. It could be multiple vision, hearing, epilepsy, and so on. And they love to participate in social life. So the final thing learning for today is that after knowing this much information, you should be able to arrange in a good axis, okay, in a good way. Step one, step two, step three, step four, step five, okay, for summarizing a case with CP. So the goal is that you take a good history, you do a good examination, you pick up the signs, movement disorder that I told you, you do a good tone examination, you understand between spasticity and rigidity, and ultimately you know what is point number four. You have to make a multi-axial CP diagnosis for CP. So what is this multi-axis CP diagnosis? So just like in psychiatry, okay, in psychiatry if you say depression, level one, level two, level three, okay, likewise CP has a multi-axis diagnosis, okay, to put a good summary. What is this? These are the multi-axis. So the first point you should summarize is the gestation of the child. This is a term child or a preterm child. Then you have to see the neurological status of the child, okay, spastic, rigid, dyskinetic, ataxic, and then you have to tell about the comorbidity. Then you have to say about the functional status, what is the GM-FCS, and then you have to say the likely etiology of this child. Okay, see this example. You have a term bone child with perinatal asphyxia. This child is having bilateral spastic cerebral palsy, upper limbs more than the lower limbs with hip adduction, hamstrings and bilateral ankle contracture with equinus gait. So you have to tell the neurological summary in axis two. This child has comorbidities like refractory epilepsy, pseudo-barbell palsy, failure to thrive, and chronic constipation. Axis number three for comorbidities. Axis number four, this child is GM-FCS grade 5 because this child is non-ambulatory. And likely etiology, axis number five is that because this child is having a birth asphyxia. If you are able to do this as a summary, okay, there is no way the examiner can fail you. So this is how you summarize a child. I have a term child with bilateral spastic cerebral palsy, with a refractory epilepsy, with the GM-FCS grade 5, and the etiology is because of sequelae birth asphyxia. Okay, so these three cases we are gone. You can answer in the chat boxes. We are going to use this axis. Okay, only three cases, three simple cases, and that would finish our presentation for today. So how do you fill in the blanks? You have to fill in the blanks. One is gestation age. Two is the neurological syndrome. Three is the comorbidity. Four is the functional scale. Five is the etiology. Okay, so we have a 30-week preterm baby, 1.1 kg, cried immediately after birth. Cried immediately after birth, okay. Had prolonged NICU stay for severe pneumonia. At 4 years of age, the child can walk. Please answer in the chat box, okay. Please answer in the chat box. I'm asking for axis 5 means you should put only as axis 5, okay. This child is having equinus gait, can speak and sing rhymes. She can feed herself and can draw circle easily, okay. She has focal epilepsy and is on anti-epileptics. Okay, so please answer axis 5. Like for example, you can answer option 3. What is axis 5? Axis 5 is etiology. So like I put like this, okay. So this is the answer like this, right. Right. So this is a preterm child. More answers, please. Good. Okay, good. So most of you have got the answer correct. Okay. The answer is immature white matter. So whenever you think about preterm child, think about immature white matter. There is no torch infection history in this child. Okay. The child cried immediately after birth. There is no overt birth asphyxia. There is no IUGR in this child. Okay. So this is our axis one preterm, axis two spastic diplegia, axis three focal epilepsy, axis four GM-FCS grade 2 because this child can walk alone. Okay. And axis five, this child is having an immature white matter. A term child, again, give your answers, okay. 1.4 kg, did not cry at birth, required NICU stay, okay, required NICU stay. Mother had first trimester fever with skin rash. The child is bedridden with no truncal support. She has generalized spasticity, vision is affected, okay. Vision is affected, hearing is affected, she needs feeding tube and has intractable epilepsy. What is the functional status of the child? She is feeding tube, okay? No truncal support. No truncal support. Yes. So the answer is option number 3, GM-FCS grade 5. So this child is having GM-FCS grade 5. The child is a term child, spastic quadriplegic, intractable epilepsy, no truncal support, okay, cannot even sit, okay. So whenever there's no truncal support, the child needs full caregiver assistance, becomes grade 5 because of torch sequelae. The last question for the day. A term child with O negative mother develops severe jaundice, okay. On day 3, requires exchange transfusion. At 4 years, the child has no neck control, spasticity in all four limbs, twisting postures. There is a persistent morose. The child has hearing loss and on NG tube. Okay, carefully note this question. It's a bit tricky question. The child has spasticity and twisting postures. Okay, so what is the likely etiology? Sorry, what is the likely neurological status in AXIS 2? Okay, good. Few more answers. Good. Okay. So the answer is option number 3. So here the child also has spasticity, also has twisting postures. Okay. So answer is spastic quadriplegia with a dyskinesia. So this is a mixed cerebral palsy. Be careful. So if you have a dyskinetic cerebral palsy with brisk reflexes and spasticity, always go for a mixed cerebral palsy. Okay. So this is a term child with a mixed cerebral palsy with hearing loss. GMFCS is grade 5 and the etiology is cornic tress. Okay. So finally, to summarize, I hope this algorithm is self-explanatory. Just go through this algorithm, a child with a developmental delay. If there is a suggestive history, you go for key points in examination. You do a developmental examination for primitive reflex and postural reflex. Okay, if there is a doubtful history, there's a family history of red flags, unexplained movement disorder, there's a regression of milestones, think about CP mimics, hereditary spastic paraparesis, leukodystrophy and dystonia. Do a motor examination, look at the gait and the posture, look at the movements, look at the tone, look at the power, deformity, okay? Do a good functional status, give a grading for GMFCS and then make a multi-axis CP diagnosis, okay? I hope this is clear, okay? This is your summary slide for, okay, history is first trimester, second trimester, third trimester, low birth weight history, okay, sentinel event history, okay? Developmental examination, motor examination, functional status examination, okay? I hope this presentation is clear. So I always sincerely believe that everything should be made simple, but not very simpler. Okay. If I want very simpler, then I should call students from class 5 and class 6 and teach them. You know, I should teach my child about cerebral palsy. But the idea here was to make it simple, but not very, very simple so that it looks very ridiculous. Okay. So at this point, we will take questions. We will take questions in the chat box. A few questions at least. Yeah. And few questions before we wind up. Any questions to me? I'm audible, I think so. Yeah. Chat box, or you can even ask through your audio itself. Okay. Okay, that's a very good question. I'll read out the question. Is there a regression of milestones seen with CP? Okay, very good question. Excellent question, whoever has asked this. So there is something called pseudo-regression in cerebral palsy. Pseudo-regression. Okay, I didn't put that slide, but it's a very good question. Okay. So if a child with a CP develops a bad epilepsy, okay, or a child with a CP develops a bad movement disorder, okay, the child can have regression of milestones. In fact, this is the reason that we say a child with the CP, okay, the epilepsy and the movement disorder should be treated aggressively, because if you don't treat an epilepsy in a CP aggressively or a movement disorder in a child with CP aggressively, they would have a pseudo regression of the milestones and they would go back. Not only would they go back, they will not also gain their milestones in future to that good degree, okay. So a pseudo regression of milestones can be seen in CP, especially the children with CP develops a brain tumor. This is very rare. It has been seen that some children with CP can have brain tumors, and then you see why this is happening. You will think, oh, it's only CP, but then you do an imaging, there will be a new onset brain tumor, okay? Or a new onset hydrocephalus. Let us say the child with CP had a tubercular meningitis and hydrocephalus. So these are the three or four things. A child with CP can have regression if there is a bad epilepsy, bad movement disorder, new onset hydrocephalus, and new onset brain tumors, okay? That's a good question, right? Can a child with CP can have chorea and dystonia in adulthood too with a normal IQ? As I told, movement disorder can start to happen at any point of time, even in adolescence sometimes, especially if there was a small brain injury in the globus pallidus. Okay. Yes, small injury in the globus pallidus children can have a normal IQ, okay? But if the MRI is absolutely normal, then you should doubt the diagnosis of CP itself. It could be a dopa-responsive dystonia, okay? It may not be a CP. I have so many cases in my life, I have seen children with dopa-responsive dystonia labeled as CP, going to orthopedics, wearing ankle-foot orthosis, going for Botox, but actually not at all a CP. They would have a normal MRI brain, okay? MRI brain should be abnormal, damaged to call it as a CP. If you have a normal MRI brain, it is not a CP. Okay, it could be a genetic disease or a metabolic disease. Okay, is dissociation a feature of a CP? I did not go into the developmental trajectories of deviance and dissociation. Okay, deviance is a feature of CP, but dissociation is usually not seen in CP because CP, in addition, is a motor syndrome. Okay, so you would have at least two domains affected in your developmental domains. You have your speech and behavior affected with the motor. So you actually cannot call it as a dissociation. Okay, so technically speaking, CP can be having only deviance and not a dissociation. How does vaccination differ in CP? Never ever. All vaccinations can be given in CP. All vaccinations can be given in CP. All vaccinations can be given in CP. Okay. Unless if the child has a very bad epilepsy and the child is on steroids for West syndrome and so, okay, which I didn't say, right? Okay, I hope the presentation was clear in terms of concepts, okay? But if there are any questions, sorry, I didn't put my Google address here. I have my own YouTube channel where I would post the videos. This is my YouTube channel called Neuro on Lectures. Okay. If anybody wants to join, they can join. There are, I always keep the presentation simple, but it will be slightly exhaustive for you to understand. Okay. Will late diagnosis lead to permanent muscle atrophy? Not exactly permanent muscle atrophy. There'll be a disuse atrophy. Upper motor syndrome would always have a disuse or not using an atrophy. And yes, they, because of failure to thrive, they can have a very bad atrophy, but if you focus on the rehabilitation, it can improve. Okay. Right. Any more questions? 10 seconds. We are 1.5 hours here. Right. If there are any more questions, no more questions, I would thank KMC Association for giving me opportunity. I do keenly teach all students, right from MBBS to PGs to DM students. Okay. So if you find my lectures,